So moving on to the next point. So I'm gonna let Rhett and Zach kind of
we've been like
talk about this. So my thing, the visual of Luke milking the space giraffe thing, whatever, I don't know if it has a name yet.
Thalassiren.
Whatever.
Yes, it does. I got you.
I'm sorry, but everyone's complaining about that, but like when the first few minutes, few seconds you're seeing Luke, it's like that's what he goes into. Like, not seconds, they have a little interaction there first. But just that, and then him walk around spearfishing and stuff, that was okay because most of those scenes were about Rey's reaction watching him. And it took me like two or three times before I really caught that that's what those scenes were about, because I'm so focused and just in full adoration of Mark Hamill that I wasn't paying attention to her at all. But like once
there's not a lot to pay attention to her in this film about anyways.
Right.
She has, I think even Rhett will agree, she has the least arc in this film.
This, it just goes up.
What, how much you agree with her arc is another thing, but or if she has an arc, but she
character
has the
is
least
a whole other category, but I don't know, just some of those visuals and things like that, it felt like it was like kind of dragging me out of the climactic moment of her sending the lightsaber, him tossing it for shock value, and then like he goes on this little like his day in the life of a Jedi and hermit, and it's just weird.
I actually don't have a problem with the aliens, and I like when the alien looks over at her like what?
That's
what?
One of the worst parts. He's like, this is every day.
No,
I've been waiting for him.
I think Zach and I had this conversation the other day. That is probably one of the most Star Wars aspects.
I felt
about
so
this
taken out of the Star Wars universe with that. I was like,
well, so,
I don't need to see him milking a what, do bag for blue milk?
Bantha.
I'm like,
a
I don't need to see that.
But no, that's exactly the point, though. They milk Banthas for the blue milk that Luke drinks in A New Hope. We only get to see where it comes from in this one. That is, I don't have
only
a problem
as
with
if
that.
It's something I've been like wishing for ever
seen
since I saw Star
right.
Wars.
Like, it's just
anyway.
I have no issue with the Thalassiren thing. I'm totally okay with it.
Okay, this gets me.
I just thought it was gross.
Yeah, I was like, and it's a huge close up of the nipple. I'm like, what are we doing here? Anyway,
I remember
but it was
sitting there just going, I could have been done without that. But you know,
right.
I thought it was selling that he's all like, this is what I'm doing, and you can leave at any
that's,
time.
Yes,
you
no,
can
that
leave
is
at any time.
That is absolutely the other part of it. Him drinking it and spilling it all over his beard
right.
is very much like, I'm going to gross you out as much as I can so that you
like,
leave me
you,
alone.
You were worshiping me, or you were so coming to look out, seek out this legendary Luke Skywalker. This is what I'm
here
doing.
You go.
Here's what I'm up
here
to.
You
right
deal
now.
With it.
I just, and I all even right. think I said in the movie after that happened, I was like, I wish I could drink milk that way. I wish I had the freedom to drink milk that way, because I would do it every time.
The other thing in that scene that really bugged me, and Rhett and I had an argument about this. I don't like, what are the inhabitants on Octo?
The caretakers.
The caretakers. Why would Luke, going into complete solitude, where he even says, I'm going here to die, and he also says, I'm going here because I want the Jedi to flare out of existence, to just be done. He says all that, and yet he's there living among these villagers who knows how long they've been on this island, which is this most secret place in the galaxy, who are taking care of the structures and the temple ruins of this Jedi temple or whatever civilization was there. Why are they there? If he's there to let it die, but keep the walls looking pretty and the rocks in place, that makes no sense. And I don't like the idea of him being there, like, meditating and just becoming one with the Force and just finishing his life and everything, where there's these inhabitants there with him. At the end of the last movie, it didn't show villages or huts or anything. I didn't need to. But it's like, I love the idea of him being there by himself in seclusion, like Ben. It's not like you showed Ben walking around with a bunch of, house servants or Jawas or something.
That we know of.
That we
know
of.
So, my big counter to that is, do you want to see Luke in a scene where he shows up and murders an entire species?
No.
Just because they're caretaking for a
they
village?
Needed to be omitted completely. What do they
no,
need to
do? No, but that's a meta
for?
Story thing. That is the meta concept of the author having to remove,
so,
in my opinion, the caretakers the caretakers work, specifically because the buildings that they were taking care of would have dissipated thousands of years ago. Since they have been there since the inception of the Jedi, apparently, because it is the carving of the Prime Jedi that is within the Jedi Temple. So they've been there for thousands upon thousands of years. In that time frame, that village would have completely disappeared. So, as far as the concept of this Jedi village and this Jedi temple, either it's all melted away and dissipated into nothingness, or you have something that's taking care of it. A species that has an entire culture based around the idea of keeping these buildings alive, I think is interesting.
Do you think that's a little morbid of the Jedi to, like, assign a species to
I don't
do
think
this
they
for
were
their entire existence?
I think the concept is more that the Jedi were these holy beings, not that the Jedi should consider themselves as such, but that they would be perceived as such by the local inhabitants.
So they enjoyed that worship, and they, like, put them to work.
No, they wouldn't enjoy the worship, but the caretakers are there keeping alive this concept as they understand it.
Well, seems like manipulating the society to do their chores.
So here's
you
a question.
Think of it.
If you were to remove the caretakers, do you think a lot of audiences would have thought, why are these ruined buildings still standing? Because they look pretty bad.
I don't think that would have, I don't think true, that's a thought that would have occurred,
okay.
But I think it adds to the depth of Ochto or Octo or whatever you want to call it. I think it would have added to the depth by having them there. I don't think, because like with Yavin 4, as you find out later through Expanded Universe stuff, the Masasi temples are there because freaking Exar Kun came in and built them using the slave labor of the populace.
As a Sith master, by
you,
the way.
Okay, yeah. So you don't think they were absolutely necessary for story purposes, but you like that it adds depth to the universe.
Or the Jedi history.
That if they are... To say that they were completely necessary to the plot of the movie as we saw it, like, maybe not. But it adds depth and story to it that you have this race of people there that are taking care of these buildings.
I guess the thing is, does it add to the movie? Because it can add to the lore, but does it contribute to
they were
the
there
movie?
For one
I
reason,
think it does.
Because it was just to be punchlines with Rey.
And I completely
That's
disagree.
It.
There's one punchline with them.
There's like three.
There's one.
She breaks
solid
the wagon.
There's two.
They're like complaining
when
she shoots
blasts
the hole.
When she shoots the blaster,
yeah.
And then when she the rock falls on top of it.
And then his
line,
when Luke's line, where she's like, "They don't like me." He's like, "I wonder why." Like there was like a few jokes that were just because of her interaction.
If you want to say there's any creatures invented for the pure purpose of jokes, that is the porgs. Beyond that,
I thought the porgs were useless.
Yes, they are.
And they were just for humor and
to sell toys.
And cartoony humor.
Yeah. Josh, what did you think?
They're the Ewoks.
No.
Well, I thought that the caretakers, going back to that, I thought that they... I don't think they're necessary. If they weren't there, I wouldn't have affected my ability to enjoy the movie, or I don't know if it necessarily added anything, but it did add... I felt like it added to the holiness of the place, because...
That's what I'm saying.
You know, you think about the temple, right? There are people who go and their whole, I mean, they retire and they basically go to the temple, you know, every week and clean the temple and do the things in the temple because of their religious conviction for it. I mean, these caretakers could be just looked like as temple workers who go and they respect it. They respect the religion. They respect the holiness of the Jedi. And so they, you know, they spend their entire lives you know, respecting that, considering it was such a holy place. So I think it does add the depth of the place where he is by having him there.
Maybe.
If they weren't there, would it have made a huge difference? I don't think so, but I do agree it does add depth.
It's a constant reminder of Luke's issue with the Jedi in that case, if you look at it from that perspective. He's on this island hating the Jedi, but you have these people who worship everything that the Jedi are, basically. That's interesting.
I guess it would be hypocritical.
How much
to
of that,
that?
Sorry. So how much of that though is Luke's own lack of self confidence after losing Kylo Ren? You know, I mean,
I'm not. Saying
I wonder how much of that.
it's
that
okay.
That really has to do with it. I felt like the biggest issue for Luke was his own lack of self-confidence after having another major
failure.
Another major villain arise from his bloodline, and he had no way to stop it, you know. And so I felt like that was the biggest part of this story, was his lack of self-confidence and getting back and realizing that, yeah, maybe he did fail him, but, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean it's the end kind of thing.
Right.
You know?
So let's come back and talk about Luke, because his arc is the biggest factor of the story and my biggest disappointments and many people's disappointments. I'm not some freak, but... I'll buy that.
Well, those two things are mutually exclusive. So I mean, you are kind of a freak.
Okay. So were you good with porgs? I think the porgs were beautiful, and like Kevin Smith was talking about the porgs, and he said that they added color to the Star Wars.
But
and I like that.
Chewbacca's there going to eat it, and they're all like,
"How could you not like that
scene?" It's goofy for the sake of being goofy, and it's not. It's not anything. Like, it's just silly
it's
cartooniness.
Chewbacca-ness.
If you want to talk about anything within the film that you could remove and it not affect the story, the porgs are absolutely top of the list, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with them personally. I think they're fine because
now,
it's
I think they're okay in other situations. When you're cutting to them just for humor, that's when I have a problem with it.
Like, yeah, And I would add to that, I feel like that is kind of in the same vein as some of the criticisms I had of the most recent Thor movie, and yours, Tim, as well, about it being too funny. Like, it just seems like Disney has kind of added not as thick, not necessarily as thick as Marvel, but kind of put some of that Marvel-esque comedy into the movie, and I didn't feel it was necessary. I didn't feel that was Star Wars.
Like, we're talking about, when you think about the funny scenes of episode four and five and six, there was the character interaction and the dialogue that was hilarious.
It was
and the character reactions.
Situational reactions, right?
It wasn't a
Whereas
joke.
You cut to a little cute porg that's like,
you're eating my brother, blah, blah, blah.
When they're just laying there, it's fine. Like, when they're, like, it passes by them as Rey walks out and they're all in nesting inside the Millennium Falcon, that's fine.
So you're
it's just
okay
sort
with
of
that.
Passaging.
Now, what about when they're flying later on when Chewie's in the ship? Were you okay with
I
that?
I didn't mind them being in the ship in the way. I thought it was silly when he started flying across the cockpit because it was... He would have died.
I was
literally
gonna say,
died.
The campsite scene, or when he's getting ready to eat it, that's what adds to the scene later in the cockpit, because he's like, he slowly accepted them and had to tolerate them because they were now inhabiting the Falcon, and that builds
they
up to that scene.
They could have had a setup another way that wasn't as egregiously, ridiculously cutesy and funny. Okay. Easily.
I'm fine with that.
Easily.
I mean, it wasn't something I expected going to this movie, and I
it reminded
I
me of Indiana Jones 4... When you go by the little road hogs on the road and they're completely CG and you're just like, what the?
Well, and I would say, that. I think the comparison scene in the original trilogies is actually one of those special edition scenes that they add in later. But when they show, like, it's the sunset on Tatooine as Jabba's palace in Return of the Jedi, and it's got the little frog thing. And it, like, eats the creature.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's very much...
Texture to the galaxy.
It's, well, but I think that's a porg scene to make...
Because it wasn't necessary.
It's not necessary. He added... George Lucas added that in afterwards. It's not necessary to anything. Right. It's just, like, a little bit of thing. Ryan Johnson was probably just trying to emulate that with the porgs.
But you forget, though, that's the campfire scene that people complain about. In the background, that's when Luke boards a ship to one of the most beautiful scenes in the movie.
Yep.
So that's something, it gives you something to look at.
One's not directly connected to the other, and that's the difference in the humor between the older movies and this movie.
I agree. The humor is a different taste.
Right. Yes.
Or a different flavor.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I guess we're okay with porgs. Could have been omitted.
No, I'm not okay with the porgs. I don't mind their design as much as how they were used.
Yes, you didn't like how they...
But
you were okay
They're fine. They're fine in most everything. They could have... If they hadn't been there, no one would have noticed. But they are there, and I think they're fine.
Okay, just as a quick poll, who here had a problem with Ewoks? Anyone? Is this a younger generation that had a problem with Ewoks? Because I never had
I heard it's the first generation that mostly had problems with it. The younger people don't care.
I grew up with Ewoks and never had a problem.
People that originally saw it were all like, what?
So the little kids are watching these, or do you think they're
concerned? No, they aren't gonna, yeah, they
this
aren't
is where the older people are like, what is this?
They also think the prequels are good, so I don't trust their judgment.
So maybe that first generation of people that hated the Ewoks are also the ones that really hate Porks and you. And so they're the ones that really don't like it, that everyone else are fine with it because we could deal with cute, fuzzy little things and buy plush toys.
I'm okay with them being cute and fuzzy. I didn't like how they were just cartoony in the movie. Literally, right. Just it's that one scene, little, really, where they with Chewbacca. It was ridiculous.
I love that scene. I love it. Anyway, I felt like that should have been kept, and the nipple scene should have been completely removed.
Are porks sentient? Like, can they comprehend? Is that so why they're able to react way?
This is deep cut, but in the visual dictionary, in this beautiful piece of work done by Pablo Hidalgo, it mentions that the caretakers share a similar ancestry to the porks. So that's just throwing that out.
They threw out the expanded universe canon, then the old school for sure. Because there's not evolution in the old canon. Yep. So.
Right. No, it's gone. But yeah, the caretakers have avian feet. They have avian features, all that jazz. And it specifically mentions that they
share
similar ancestry to the porks.
That's super dumb.
That's deep cut. That's what I'm saying.
That's super dumb.
So would you guys agree that these things were kind of dragging down the movie from the very first act?
No, I don't think it dragged it down at all, in my opinion. I didn't have an issue with the scenes. I'm just saying.
And I didn't either.
Contextually, if they had removed the scenes, I wouldn't have, cried at the scenes.
You wouldn't know. The porg scene preceded, one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie, which is Luke seeing R2-D2, which is, arguably having an understanding of tone is an issue.
How you have the Chewie scene right before that scene, you mean?
Right.
Right.
Tone matters.
Yeah.
But not to Marvel or Disney.
Well, but when you jump into the, when he steps in the cockpit, you forget about Chewie. I wasn't trying to get over laughing. Like, it wasn't Thor Ragnarok where I'm trying to unwind from laughing from one scene and then going into this big dramatic genocide.
There,
in the next
there
scene.
Is some space in between when he actually gets R2-D2.
Yeah. And I enjoy it. And again, that's one of the most beautiful. And that's where it picks up, where it could have been redeemed a little bit. And I wasn't bothered by the movie at any point when they were going through all the porgs and stuff. I didn't like seeing the big nipple, and I didn't understand why we were going that direction with the movie, when I'd rather spend more time with training or crazy Luke and stuff instead of that, but that's okay. Any other any thoughts on Octo before we move on with the story?
I have lots of thoughts on Octo, but we can move on.
As far as the plot and the story, anything else, Josh?
Yes.
No.
Okay.